pareció vida mía, me dio la felicidad. En tu pecho, vida mía, me dio la felicidad. Tus ojos, claro de monte, como guitarras trovadoras de San Juan. Tus ojos son mi suplicio, son mi perdón, mi redención, mi despertar. Tus ojos que me arrebatan, son mi locura, son la plena perdición. Tus ojos lo tienen todo.
So good morning, everyone. So we'll continue from where we left the other time. So I hope all can see the document that we are going to be discussing. I think we left at the example 7. And what we had there was that a dielectric rod or fiber of a transparent material can be used to guide light or an electromagnetic wave under conditions of total internal reflection. So we are required to determine the minimum dielectric constant of the guiding medium so that the wave incident on one end of the rod at any angle will be confined within the rod until it emerges from the other end. This is an application where we'll have the optical fiber communication, where copper is replaced by glass fiber or quartz. So what we are looking at is, although this one looks a little bit dark, of course you can see a watermark, almost like a watermark, that would be our dielectric fiber. And what we are saying that is the, when this is the axis of the fiber itself, we are approaching the axis of the fiber at an angle of theta I. And therefore that theta I, or the transmitted wave inside into the dielectric, will be at an angle of theta T, which is the angle of refraction. And it will approach the normal to the cylindrical surface at theta 1. And what we are saying is that this theta 1 should be greater than the critical angle for total internal reflections to take place. And therefore, the reflected wave will be reflected at an angle theta 1, and it will be the same for all of them. And with an approach of theta I, you can get total internal reflection all throughout until the wave emerges at the other end of the fiber. So what we are saying is that we must have that theta 1 be greater than the critical angle for that medium, okay, so that total internal reflection takes place. And therefore, we can write that sine theta 1 must be greater than sine theta I C. And since theta 1 is equal to pi by 2 or 90 degrees minus theta T, or the angle of reflection, which we can see immediately from here, okay, this would be an angle theta T, and this being the normal, then theta 1 must be the angle 90 degrees minus theta T. And therefore, the cosine of theta T would be greater than sine theta IC when we look at these angles here. Okay, when we take the sine of theta 1 and it's equal to the sine of pi by 2 minus theta t, you see that this one will just be the cosine of theta t. From Snell's law of refraction, we know that sine theta t is given by 1 over the square root of the dielectric constant of the medium 1, for which the medium 1 for our case is the dielectric medium, and multiplied by the sine angle of the angle of incident. And therefore, when we have this, then we can see that that minus that is going to be given by epsilon naught by epsilon 1, which is equal to 1 over epsilon r 1, or you can see that the dielectric constant should be greater than 1 plus sine squared theta I. The maximum value that will be achieved is when theta I is just grazing, that is, the when we make the wave approach the dielectric at an angle of 90 degrees here, okay, that's the limiting angle, and therefore we can see that we can therefore see that the theta epsilon r1 must be at least equal to 2 when we put that sine theta I equal to 1. So it must be greater than 2, or in other words, the refractive index of the medium should be greater than the square root of 2. And this will be satisfied mainly by quartz or the silicon oxide based glasses, so to speak. Now, we look at the diffraction grating, where we have, you know, wires in which the wave will be approaching a wire mesh, and we want to see what happens when the wave goes through such a medium. So we can say that a periodic grating of wires, slots, or a similar perturbations will always radiate or diffract an incident plane wave in certain directions, which we'll call the diffraction orders of the grating. This you may have seen when you are trying to measure the, you know, the wavelengths of, you know, of light in when you do spectroscopy. So the phase coefficients of these directions on the two sides of the grating will differ by an integer multiple of twice pi between the grating elements. So we consider such a grating where we have this one's a material with holes poked into them. And the elements are separated by a distance d, and they are oriented along the x-axis, and the wave is moving in the positive z direction in that nature. At the top of the grating and the bottom of the grating, we have the same medium. So we have mu and epsilon, and mu and epsilon. So the epsilon, the mu and epsilon of the dielectric is going to be very small. It's going to be different. So, as shown, the wave is assumed to approach the bottom surface of the grating at an angle of theta I to the normal. And the propagation constant in the x direction is therefore going to be given by k multiplied by the sine of theta I. The phase difference between the induced effects in adjacent grating elements is then going to be given by kd and multiplied by sine theta I. And the wave is radiated at the top side of the grating at an angle of transmission that is given by theta t. So for constructive interference, we must have that kd sine theta I must be equal to kd sine theta t plus or minus twice n pi, that is integer multiples of twice pi. And this, you can recall, is what we were talking about when we were discussing the crystals. When you are doing crystallography, the atoms are arranged in planes, and those planes can be taken to be like the gratings that we are looking at, where d is the interatomic separation. Okay, and therefore we can see that the sine of theta t is going to be given by the sine of theta I plus or minus n lambda by 2, by d rather. So the angle theta t equal to theta I for n equal to 0 is usually called the principal order of the grating, and the other diffraction orders or side lobes will occur when sine theta I plus or minus n lambda by d is less than unity, or in other words, d is greater than half the wavelength of the wave of the light that you are using. So many times we'll have that the light is elliptically polarized rather than plane linearly polarized. I want to see what happens in that case. So the incident wave will have both a parallel polarized component and a perpendicularly or normally polarized component as shown in this figure below. So this will be the parallel polarized wave, and the one coming out would be the normally polarized wave. And therefore, we can analyze this situation by superposition. So what we have done is that we have tried to do, that is to retranslate, that is to rotate the coordinate system to a coordinate system that is a little bit different, that is, which is aligned with the direction of propagation of the wave itself in the different media. So as viewed from the origin, the orthogonal field components of the incident wave can be expressed as Ez equal to Ei n, the exponent of j omega t, and Ei y prime equal to Ei p, that is a parallel polarized wave, exponent of j omega t plus theta I, where this is the rotation of the coordinate system. So theta I is the angle by which Ey prime leads the Ez component. So the incident wave will have a polarization ellipse that is specified through the parameters gamma I and theta I on the axial ratio ARI and tau I, where if you recall the Poincaré's sphere of polarization, this would come from that kind of discussion we talked about. So the spherical coordinates, the spherical trigonometry, the angles will be related as shown. And this being a little bit higher than us, you know, at the level at which you're approaching this field analysis, this you'll have to take them by faith. And this is what it is, that is the gamma I will be given by the arctangent of EIP by EIN and so forth. And the subscript will denote the incident wave with a minus sign adopted for right elliptical polarization for those angles. So we consider the reflected wave as viewed from the observation point P, where P, you can see it here. This is the observation point P, and the transmitted wave will be observed at the point Q. So the orthogonal field components will then be given by that equation there, that is for the normally polarized component, will be given by the reflection coefficient for normal polarization and multiplied by the incident wave. And that for the parallel polarization, again, is given by the modulus of the polarization, okay, for parallel. And then the wave reflection coefficient for parallel polarized waves and multiply by the angles. So phi n and phi p are the phase angles of the reflection coefficients for normal and parallel polarization respectively. So the phase angle by which Ey therefore leads Ez is hence going to be given by theta r equal to theta I minus pi plus phi n minus phi p. And similarly, gamma r is going to be given by the arctangent of gamma p by gamma n tan gamma I. And these two relations will therefore specify the polarization state of the reflected wave as seen from the observation point P. In a similar way, the transmitted wave will also be looked at in the same way, that is from Q. We'll have the given value angles as shown. And we can continue with that the similar way to get the values. So an example is as follows, that a right circularly polarized wave is incident at an angle of 45 degrees from air onto A, a perfect conductor, and B, polystyrene, which has a dielectric constant of 2.7. And what we are required to find is the state, polarization state of the reflected wave in the two cases. So with a right circularly polarized wave, we have gamma I is equal to 45 degrees, delta I, which is equal to 90 degrees, where delta I is the phase angle between the two wave components, that is the EX or EY, the EP and EN. And therefore, theta R is just going to be given by that value, which is just, I mean, we are just applying the equations we just have derived. And we see that with a perfect perfectly conducting interface, then the gamma N and gamma P are both equal to minus unity, and therefore gamma R is just going to be 45 degrees. And therefore, we see that the reflected wave will be left circularly polarized. That is, we have a change of polarization of the field as it reflects off the surface. Now, for part B, for polystyrene, we compute the gamma P and gamma N as shown, where we have the 0.126 at an angle of pi and 0.354 at an angle of pi as well for both cases. And hence, theta R is going to be given by minus 90, and you see that again is 90 degrees, and similarly, the gamma R is going to be given by 19.6 degrees. And we see that tau R is going to be equal to zero, that is the tilt angle of the ellipse, the polarization ellipse for transmitted, reflected wave is at 0 degrees, and with an actual ratio of 2.81, and the wave we can see is left elliptically polarized, okay? With the transmitted wave will be right elliptically polarized. And the reason being is that we have different, the two components, that is the polarization or the normally polarized wave component will be reflected with a higher reflection coefficient than the parallel polarized wave, and therefore the amplitudes are going to be different. And instead of having a circular polarization, we'll now have elliptical polarization. So example 9 is that a parallel polarized wave that is incident on the XZ plane at an angle of 45 degrees from air onto a perfect conductor and polystyrene. What would be the polarization state of the reflected wave for these two cases if the angle of incident onto the polarization or onto the polystyrene was 58.7 degrees? What would be the polarization state of the reflected wave? Again, this is an application of the same questions that we are looking at, and this should be, you can see that the reflected wave will be linearly polarized with the electric field vector bisecting the minus z and the gamma, the y double prime axis. That is where we have tried to rotate the coordinate system to follow the propagation direction of the reflected waves. And part B, we have the same kind of equations again, and we see that the axial ratio is infinite, and the reflected wave will be linearly polarized with the electric field making an angle of 70.4 degrees with the z-axis. Now, what, and we've continued, that the angle of incident of 58.7 degrees is actually the Brewster angle for polystyrene, and hence, gamma P is going to be equal to zero, because remember, Brewster angle was where the reflection coefficient was equal to zero, and therefore we have that the reflected wave will just be consist only of the normally polarized component, and therefore the wave will be perpendicularly polarized wave. Now, when you are talking about the multiple interfaces with normal incidence, there is one thing I needed to say, that this is usually applied also in making mirrors using dielectrics that are, have a reflection coefficient that is almost unity. We know that practical conductors will never have a reflection coefficient of 100% because we don't have perfectly conducting conductors in practice. And therefore, in many cases, when you are, say, for example, we are trying to make a laser, okay, a laser system, what usually was done was that you would reflect light or the laser light between two concave, convex mirrors, okay, and we formed that, and it's called a Fabry-Perot cavity. And the way, then on one of the mirrors, you'd cut a small hole at the axis to let out the laser light that you want to use in your application. Now, what has happened is that today, many of the Fabry-Perot cases are now being implemented in, say, solid state. That is, we have solid state lasers rather than the gas lasers that we used to have before. That is like carbon dioxide laser or the neon argon laser and so forth, or the helium laser. So what we use is that maybe you have a silicon wafer, and you make the cavity inside the silicon. But since the silicon is a dielectric, then its reflection coefficient is going to be even worse than that of a metal. Another thing that would happen is that with mirrors, once you polish them very highly polished, then you are opening up the surface of the metal to the elements, and therefore it will quickly rust by reaction with the atmospheric oxygen and so forth. And therefore, you'll always have to be polishing your mirrors all the time. So with a dielectric mirror, that helps because there will be no oxidation, and therefore you can maintain your mirrors at perfect condition for longer, so to speak. So this example here, this example 10, does not appear in the document that you have already. This is an addition. And the way it is, it has been set in such a way that it appears almost like an exam question would be asked or will be posed. So we have part A, where we are saying that we are considering a 3 gigahertz uniform plane wave, electromagnetic wave, that is propagating in free space in the positive z direction. And at z equal to 0, the wave impedance is normally on a planar boundary with a sheet of a non-magnetic dielectric of the electric constant epsilon 2 and thickness L. So what we are required to do is to derive an expression for the reflection coefficient at the front face of the dielectric sheet, hence determine the value of this reflection coefficient for the case where epsilon 2 is 2.25, that is something like quartz, and L is equal to lambda 2 by 4, where lambda 2 is the wavelength of the wave in the dielectric sheet at this frequency. Usually, when it's asked like this, it doesn't look very familiar, but this is exactly the same kind of problem that we already looked at when we were discussing the reflection coefficient or the normal incident at dielectric-dielectric interfaces, where we had two interfaces instead of one. So all we have to do is to just apply those, but in an exam basis, you have been asked to derive them, and therefore all you have to do is always to just draw the diagram that you need and then fill in the values. So it's continued because it has a part B, and this is where what I was introducing about the Bragg mirror comes in. So part B says, owing to corrosion and tarnishing problems, metallic reflectors may prove unsuitable at optical frequencies for applications requiring exposure to the element. If you are going to have those mirrors in the element, especially when you are using radio telescope and the like, this is what will happen. So an alternative is often to use dielectric mismatching build a high reflectivity. Mismatching, what we are saying is that we are not going to use those waveform impedance transformers and so forth to try and get that. Okay? So in a typical arrangement, which we call the Bragg mirror, we have two N plus one alternating layers of a high and a low dielectric constant, which we can say that the high dielectric constant is 1.6 and the low dielectric constant is 1.2. The materials are formed in layers, just like sandwiches, so to speak, or hamburger, if you like. So each is made to be exactly lambda by 4, where the lambda is the wavelength in the each layer, the appropriate wavelength in the layer itself. And then this, at the end, will be backed by a quartz substrate with a refractive index of N equal to 1.46. Remember, when we refer to it as a refractive index, you must remember that that is just simply epsilon at the square root of the dielectric constant. And this is something you have to keep in mind. So the Bragg mirror itself is as shown there. So at this end, we have substrate quartz, and we have the high dielectric constant layer and the low dielectric constant layer, and so forth. The thickness is all lambda by 2 or lambda by 4. So what would happen is that when you want to make a cavity, you would put another backing on the other end with a small hole where the light will have to come out as you, once you have amplified it, you know, by the laser action. So determine the reflection coefficient at the front face of the mirror for I equal to 6 and for 1, N equal to 6 and 2, N equal to 25, and then comment on the results that you obtain. So the front face is that level, that is our light is coming through, reaching that end and going out. So you want to see when the light approaches from this end, what would be the reflection coefficient at that level there? So this one looks very weird because there are so many things to deal with, but all you have to realize is that it's the same as the part A, where we are just dealing with only two interfaces, maybe that interface and that interface, and we are just here. So that is the same kind of thing we are looking at, only that now we have many, many of them. So for part A, what I said is that always when you are trying to solve these problems, the first thing you do is to draw the picture of what the problem looks like. We have been told it's normal incidence, and we have material 3, material 2, and material 1. For our case, we have only material 1 on one side and material 1 on the other side, and in between we are placing a material with an epsilon 2. So like we did before, all we have done is to put the Z coordinate to start from the far end and therefore decrease or go in the minus Z direction as L minus L. I don't know. You should ignore the L1 here. The subscript is not important. So in medium 1, we write down the reflection or the wave components, and all we are doing is that we can, like we said before, we just assume that we have X polarized wave. We could use X or Y or Z, whatever it is we want to use, and then form the other values. This, I think I should bring it down here so that it looks okay. I was trying to reduce the length of my equation, but I must have cut it at the wrong place. So the incident electric field in component is XE I0 exponent of minus JK1 and Z, and HI is given by the direction vector multiplied by the incident electric field and divided by eta 1, and we see that it's in the y direction. The reflection coefficients as well as all the reflected wave components are also as shown there. So in the dielectric sheet, we have a forward moving electric field component, and the magnetic field component. Again, here we have the same issue, and a negative or the negative Z propagating a wave in the opposite direction, which is E2 and E1, just like we had before. Okay? And in medium 3, we have the transmitted wave that is just going as before, and the continuity of the tangential component of the total electric field in medium 2 at the back phase will therefore yield that equation there. That is, we are looking at the tangential components of the total electric field component, that the forward moving wave component amplitude and the backward moving wave must be equal to the wave that is moving in the transmitted wave at that interface. In other words, all we are saying is that the amplitudes of the wave component must be equal there. And again, for the electromagnetic field component, we have the same value for this. The difference between the forward wave component amplitude minus and the backward moving or the reflected wave component must be given by the ratio of the intrinsic impedances and multiplied by the amplitude of the transmitted wave. And thus, we can divide the first and the second equation, okay, to obtain a value for the reflected wave in medium 2 or in the dielectric sheet, and we'll see it with a reflection coefficient kind of quantity here applied by the amplitude of the forward wave. And this is what we define as the reflective coefficient for that medium at that particular position, and we call it gamma at z equal to 0, and we call it E20 minus over E20 plus, and we see it as that. So we'll use the total wave impedance in medium 2 to define the reflection coefficient at any position z. So the total fields in the dielectric sheet are therefore going to be given by that equation there, and then for the electric field and for the magnetic field, it will be given by the same equation, that is eta, okay, cross, and then we get that value there. So we define a total wave impedance in medium 2 as the amplitude of the electric field at z and the magnetic field at z. And this gives us that equation. And when we replace the expression for gamma 0, we get that kind of expression, which is the same kind of, which is the same expression we obtained in the earlier discussion. And therefore, at the front face, we have that z at minus L1 is equal to eta into that. I'll remove the subscript when I correct this particular whatever document before sending it to you. And here, we have just used a B to try and make our life easy by making B being the ratio of the intrinsic impedance of medium 1 divided by the intrinsic impedance of medium 2. And therefore, the reflection coefficient at the front face is just going to be given by gamma minus L equal to Z minus L1 minus eta 1 and Z of minus L1 plus eta 1. Remember, the reason why we don't have an eta 3 is because this should have been eta 3, but because medium 3 is the same as medium 1, we are just using the intrinsic impedance of medium 1. And therefore, for L1 equal to lambda by 4 in medium 2, then we have a transformer, and we see that the ZL minus 1 is going to be given by eta 2 squared by eta 1. And hence, we can see that the reflection coefficient is just going to be given by 1 minus b squared over 1 plus b squared. And we see that this is just going to be given by the minus 0.385. or 38.5%. And we see that for a single interface, the reflection coefficient is very low. Okay, and I want you to keep this in mind as we look at equation at part B on this example. So for the second example, the part B, we see the Bragg mirror as we had in the equation, and we have put in the substrate, which is quartz, with the reflective index of 1.46. And now we want to attack this the same way. So all you have to do is to put your Z at this point, okay? And then you can put the other medium here, then you can come and, you know, define a reflection coefficient for that level. Then you'll get an impedance at this level. And now you will ignore that, and now again get a reflection coefficient for that level, and so forth, going backward. Now this reminds you of the cascaded amplifier stages that you dealt with in electronics, analog electronics in the third year. Okay, you start from the end that you know, and you go closer and closer towards the direction where you are coming from. So you are needed to go. So what we do is that we let the reflection coefficient at the zeroth interface be lambda naught, where we are counting the boundaries from the quartz EH interface and defined NQ and N eta Q, eta H, and eta L as the intrinsic impedances of the quartz, the high dielectric, and the low dielectric media, constant materials, respectively. And thus, we can simply write that eta naught or the gamma naught at the interface nearest the quartz just going to be given by eta q minus eta h over eta q plus eta h. Okay? And for the non-magnetic materials, we can see that eta is just going to be given by the square root of eta naught by eta r, that is the dielectric constant multiplied by the constant. Okay, the free space permittivity epsilon naught, in which case is the intrinsic impedance of free space divided by the square root of epsilon r or the refractive index. And therefore we have that given by that. So gamma naught is therefore going to be given by 1 by nq, that is the refractive index of the quartz, minus 1 over the refractive index of the high dielectric constant material over that value, and we can correct that in that form. The input impedance seen at the first boundary is then going to be given by, remember we say that the thickness of the layer is lambda by 4 in that material, and therefore since the first material, the first layer of NH is quarter wavelength, then we can see that at the first interface, we see that Z1 is just going to be eta 1 squared over eta Q, okay? And we can see that it's just NQ over N1 squared over eta naught, so to speak, okay? And that at the second boundary is going to be given by Z2, and we see that now this would be the value, we'll use the intrinsic impedance of that layer, that is the effective intrinsic impedance is just going to be Z1. And again, we'll see that just we now use the Z1 and the value, and we can see that that is going to be the admittance, okay, rather than impedance, divided by the intrinsic or the refractive index of the medium 2 all squared at that level, okay? And if we follow that, we can see that all of them are going to be following the same kind of value. That is, all you have to note is that we are having an impedance or an intrinsic impedance of the layer that we are dealing with divided by the effective intrinsic impedance of the layer behind it, okay, as we are coming through. And then we can see that it's just the admittance of that divided by the refractive index of the material you are dealing with, and so forth as we go along. And therefore, we can use induction to form an expression that the impedance of the dielectric or the effective intrinsic impedance of the dielectric or the wave impedance of that material at the position I, at the ith interface, is going to be given by the intrinsic impedance of the ith layer divided by the wave impedance of the layer just behind it. You see that it's just going to be the admittance of the layer just behind it over the refractive index squared of that layer itself, where I is equal to 2, 3, and so forth. And Ni is going to be given Nh when I is odd, and it's going to be Nl when I is even. And therefore, we can see that for the given structure, we can see that at the 2n plus 1 interface, then we would have the y of the 2n over the value of n 2n plus 1. And we can see that that is just going to be given by 1 over that, multiplied by that. And we can see that following. And we can put that into, you know, kind of, what do you call them? We can put them into products, and we see that these are just going to be given by those equations there. And we see that the first wave impedance just separates out nicely, and we have the multiplication of the refractive index, the ratios of the refractive index all through. So this can be written in a mathematical form as the wave impedance going to be given by the refractive index of the quartz divided by the refractive index of the first layer multiplied by eta naught and multiplied by the product of the ratios of the rest, where I is equal to 1 to n, I think we should be 2, and so forth. And therefore, you see that this is going to be En by Eh, epsilon L by epsilon H, and we can see that that is just going to be given by epsilon L by epsilon H or raised to n. And that's the way the Bragg mirror will work, and therefore, we want to see how the reflection coefficients are going to be for a Bragg mirror. So when n is equal to 6, then the Z2n plus 1, therefore 2 times 6 plus 1 is 13. The 13th impedance is just going to be given by n cube n naught over epsilon h and multiply by that raised to the value of n that we have there. And you see that it's just going to be 0.162 multiplied by the intrinsic impedance of free space. And therefore, the reflection coefficient for a Bragg mirror with 6 layers is going to be given by 0.162 minus 1 over 0.162 plus 1. And you see that now we have a higher reflection coefficient than we had with just as 2 layers or two interfaces. If we were to make the n equal to 25, then we can see that the value of the wave impedance is getting smaller and smaller. It's becoming almost a short circuit, so to speak. And in the end, this should be 51 rather than 13, and we get a value of 0.999, reflection coefficient, almost 100%. And we note that the reflection is almost total, that is almost like that for a wave, for a dielectric perfect conductor interface. And therefore, all you have to do is to increase the number of layers that you have, and you get almost 90 degrees. So can you quickly try to compute a value for n given to, say, 100 or 50? Let's call it 50. We double the number of n. Just take 1 minute or so to get that value.
Minus one. Okay. So what I want to do is
answer minus follow answer minus one choice answer minus one divided by answer plus one. So minus 9 9 9 9 8 6 7. So did you get a value? So, any feedback? Hey, are we in class, people? Or do you just give me just your pictures and disappear?
Negative 0.9973.
Well, I got myself a 0.59 followed by 8867. How did you do it?
Wow. Okay. Let me redo it.
Yeah, it's 1.2 divided by 1.6 raised to 50 is going to be a very small number. So anyway, now you can try to do that. This is the kind of questions that you may be asked in an exam kind of situation. And you can see there is no difference from what we have just discussed in class. The only thing you do is now to apply the small things we've been talking about, okay? It's just an application of things. And when you go to the field, this is the same kind of thing you'll be dealing with. So many times, we see that the student gets overwhelmed when they see something like that. But all you have to do is to do the way the British Empire was built, that is divide and conquer. Never look at the question as a whole. Look at this, the parts as they appear, and you'll be okay all the time. There's nothing new that you are dealing with. So what I want to do is to introduce what we have seen. We have just looked at the wave itself as a what do you call it? The reflection, and this is what we were calling specular reflection. Scattering would be done now when we have a surface that is not smooth. That is, we cannot say that we have an angle of reflection and the angle of incidence being equal and so forth. This is what is called wave diffraction, and it's the way we know that sound can go around corners or round objects, while light cannot. The reason why this is the case is because of just the difference in the wavelengths. Sound waves have longer wavelengths, and therefore, and they would be, the wavelength would be of the same order of magnitude as the object that is obstructing it. For the optical, optical fields or optical waves, the wavelengths are very, very small. Say, for example, the red light has a wavelength of about 700 nanometers, while the blue light would be having something like 400 nanometers, so to speak. And these are very small compared to the normal objects that would be in the path of the light, and therefore we say that the light cannot go around objects or something like that. But when you look at, say, microwave or radio waves, you can see that most of the, we may have objects that are of the same order of magnitude as the wavelength of the signal. And therefore, we expect that light being, or the electromagnetic wave being a wave as well, it can also go around or bend around objects, so to speak. Scattering is when we have, say, for example, you shine an electromagnetic wave onto, say, for example, a material that is made up of particles, say, for example, smoke in a burning house, or the clouds that are just water molecules, so to speak. So when you send light there, some of it will be reflected by the cloud, but the scattering will be in all directions. Okay, and therefore we can say that the reflection is just scattered, so to speak. You cannot say that there's a direction of the reflected wave that is, you can identify. This may be a problem in some cases, but in other cases we actually apply, or we want to use that that condition, especially, say, for example, in a room. In a room, you don't want to have your light source just focusing light in one direction alone. You want the light to go all throughout the room. That way, you can use less light sources, so to speak. And therefore, that's why we always have, say, for example, you are asked to make maybe kind of paint your walls with rough ink or rough paint and so forth, so that when light reflects on the walls, instead of being specularly polarized or specularly reflected in a given direction, it's just scattered in all different directions, and therefore your room can be filled with light, so to speak. So what we are going to do is to try and look at diffraction, and this is just an introduction. We are not going to pretend to cover it exhaustively. The first important principle that is used is the Huygens principle, okay? And we shall be looking at physical optics as well as the geometric optics, where physical optics is where we are looking at the waves in terms of waves, and the geometric optics we'll be looking at it in terms of rays. Say, for example, in this diagram here, we are saying that we have a point source, and a point source will be producing light in all different directions, and therefore it will be having wavefronts that are spherical. They are radiating away from the point source in a spherical way. Now, we can say that at a distance r from the source, we can always say that this particular wavefront, like the bigger wavefront, can be treated as being produced, small waves being produced at different points along the primary wavefront to form the bigger secondary wavefront at that end, and so forth. This is what is called Huygens' principle, okay, of the diffraction. So the Huygens principle is fundamental in physical optics, and it is used to explain how radio waves bend around obstacles, or rather what we call diffraction of waves. And it states that as follows: at each point on a primary wavefront could be regarded as a new source of a secondary spherical wavelet, and the secondary wavefront then constructed as the envelope of these wavelets. Now we consider a conducting strip that is oriented in the x direction, okay, and that is the z direction, and it's protruding from the half space, the minus x half space, into the positive x half space by a distance a, which we are going to assume to be small. And we are looking at the wavefront, okay, of an incident wave, uniform plane wave of amplitude E naught approaching the z equal to zero plane, okay? And therefore we can see that the wavefront will be extending from zero, from infinity to infinity. The one up to A will be obstructed by the conducting plane, so it will be reflected back. But where the conducting plane is not there, it should move out. And therefore, if we used geometric optics, we'd expect a sharp shadow on that end. That is, all this would be dark, and the top here would be light on this other end. Okay? But this is what now we want to show, that this is usually not the case. So you consider a field point P, a distance R, from the conducting half plane. The distribution or the contribution of the spot, the dE, to the field at P from a point source, a distance x above the axis, is given by dE equal to ER naught divided by R and the exponent of the jk of R plus delta R, where the delta R are given as shown in this diagram. Here we are using Huygens' principle. We are taking that this wavefront will have every point on the wavefront around this point will be a source of the electric field, or will contribute an electric field to at P. Okay? And here we are saying that this delta R is, of course, from that end of the sphere to the source point itself, and R is the radius of this spherical surface that we have defined here in magenta. So that is the small contribution. This will appear from the spherical coordinates, okay, and you'll get this kind of thing. And this we shall see, especially when we look at point sources, when we look in the second semester, so to speak, we'll get similar kind of values looking like that. And therefore, the electric field at P, that from Huygens' principle, will be the integral over the x-axis of all the contributions from those point sources on that wavefront. Or in other words, we can see that since we are integrating with respect to x, it will not affect R, and therefore we can take that one out and integrate from A, that is where the end of the conducting strip, to infinity. This can be, if we were to make that the delta R will be much smaller than R, then we can always use the cosine rule to show that the delta R is just going to be approximately x squared over 2R, so to speak, where we have the angle, or the triangle, that triangle here. We can always get the value of that delta R. And therefore, and let zeta squared, we define zeta squared as 2 divided by R multiplied by lambda, where lambda is a wavelength of the wave that we are dealing with. And we let that U be given by zeta multiplied by the x, that is the height above the origin or the plane. And therefore, it means that dx is just going to be given by du and divided by zeta that we have defined there. So we can always now use this substitution into the equation for the total field at P, and we see that it's going to be E naught over zeta r exponent of minus jkr, and the integral from zeta a to infinity, and the exponent of minus j pi by 2 u squared and du. And this, once you see this, you can remember that we had similar kind of integrals when we were looking at the energy distribution among particles, the Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution functions and the likes. And therefore, we can split this as an integral from 0 to infinity of that expression, du, minus the one now from 0 to zeta a. Okay? And then we split this one into the Euler's, using the Euler's formula for cosine and sine, and then we get it as follows. So once we integrate, we can see the first one integrates to 1 by 2, just from the usual cases. That is, this one is something that we know how to integrate. Okay? But this one is a bit difficult. So this is what we have done, that we have just a half for the first integration, and the other is the sine part, and then we have the integral of the next one. These ones are special functions called the Fresnel integrals. So see, Zr is the cosine of pi u squared by 2 du, and the S zeta a is the integral of zero zeta to a sine pi by u squared by 2 du. And these are called the Fresnel's cosine and sine integrals. You really don't have to put this in mind. This will be given as, for completeness sake, so that we can see that we are required to introduce diffraction as well. So the time average power density is, from Poynting's theorem, going to be given by the real part, a half real part of E cross H conjugate. And if we do that, we just see that it's going to be given by the amplitude of the wave squared divided by 2 and the real part of the intrinsic impedance of the medium through which the wave is flowing. And you can see that that's just going to be given by a half P naught into the modulus of the Fresnel and cosine and sine, sine integral, so to speak, where the P naught is just simply the E naught over 2 eta lambda by R, where we can recall that E naught squared by 2 eta is, of course, the power density in the incident wave alone. Okay? And we see that this, therefore, P naught, therefore, varies as R, rather than R squared, and therefore we can see that it's going to be a cylindrical wave rather than a spherical wave. So the variation of the field intensity on the illuminated and shadow sides of the wave of the half plane is therefore qualitatively as illustrated, where we'll have the illuminated side will have dark and light places, and then it will go down to zero to the shadow side. Okay, and therefore we note the following. For when we have no conducting plane at all, the average power is going to be just the same average power density in the incident wave, because there is no obstruction. When we put the conducting strip flush with the y equal to zero plane, or the x equal to zero plane, then we have that the power average is just going to be a quarter of what it was. And if we make it infinite, That is, we have complete obstruction, we have power average, or the upper average power density is zero. And therefore, Huygens' principle of diffraction will be useful also in holography. Holography is where you can see a 3D image, especially, I don't know whether nowadays Microsoft also does the same. I don't know whether any of you has ever bought a Microsoft product. Or we all use the cracked versions. So if you buy a Microsoft product, they will always be having an image there to show them the authenticity, where you can see a 3D image on a 2D plane, so to speak. That is what is called holography, where you are storing both the amplitude data and the phase data of the light that is shining on the object, so to speak. And that's what holography is all about. Now, when you look at geometric optics, we see that the geometric optics, we are just looking at following the ray paths of the radiation itself. And therefore, it is really a point-to-point ray correspondence between successive positions on a wavefront. Physical optics, instead, uses a point to a spherical wave correspondence, as we have seen there. And therefore, in a simplified way, you can say that geometric optics uses the concept of ray paths, while physical optics uses the concept of wavefronts. So the geometric optics approximation will always assume that the power flow is in a tube of rays and is going to be constant throughout. That is, there's no leakage of power from one ray to another. And therefore, we can always consider it as a high frequency limit of the physical optics approximation. So to illustrate this, what we have is that we have a tube made of four rays, that is that ray at the top of the surface area and those two on the other edges. And we have two spherical surfaces, okay, elements of surface of area A1 and area A2, a distance big R from the primary source and a distance R plus small r from the source at A2. Remember that A2 and A1 are spherical surfaces, and therefore they will be dependent on the angle. They have the same solid angle element at the source. They subtend the same angle at the source, so to speak. So the power flowing through A1 and A2 is therefore from geometric optics the same, and therefore it's just going to be given by the surface area multiplied by the power density that is crossing that surface area, and it must be the same as the power going through the surface area A2. P1, of course, will be defined as usual as the real part or half the real part of that value, where we are using eta as a real impedance. Say, for example, we are looking at free space, and therefore we just have the modulus of E1 over twice eta. And P2 will be given by that. And this will be the power densities at the positions of A1 and A2 respectively. And therefore, we can always get a ratio or the relationship between A1 and A2 and E2 and E1. As shown there. So the ratio A1 to A2.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
I think our time is up.
Oh, it is. I don't know why I was thinking today we are going to do. Thank you. So we'll talk about that now tomorrow then. We have reached that page 16. Thank you for reminding me that. So in case you have any issues, you can always point them out. And therefore, let's hold any questions that you have today. We shall look at them tomorrow. Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you too.
Have a good day.